and fill our homes with your presence. You alone are worthy of our reverence. As for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. As for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. As for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. We will serve the Lord. Lord, we vow to live holy, bowing our knees to you only. As for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. As for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. As for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. We will serve the Lord. Staying together, praying together, any storm we can weather, trusting in God's word. We need each other, fathers and mothers, sisters and brothers, in harmony and love. As for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. As for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. As for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. We will serve the Lord. Sing along. As for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. As for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. As for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. We will serve the Lord. We will serve the Lord. Yes, we will serve the Lord.
Well, Elwood, I cannot think of a more appropriate song for the morning's message this morning. That's exactly what we're going to be looking at. As we are preparing this evening for our installation of our deacons, one of the things that I've discovered since I've been here is just how family-oriented this church is, and that what we have is a deacon body that ministers or seeks to minister, and we will continue to seek to minister to the families of the church, because it's the families of the church that will make the church strong. And I want to share with you this morning in a message that I've just simply entitled Tale of Three Families, and that this Tale of Three Families talks about conviction. If we're not families of conviction, especially godly convictions, we will not be a church of true conviction. Especially godly convictions. You know, Peter Lord once said, "We only practice what we truly believe. All the rest is just religious talk." Conviction is instruction from God, and it's taken personally and it's taken seriously, and beliefs that actually govern our behavior. I've noted some characteristics of convictions. I want to share them with you as we get started this morning. That first of all, when we talk about convictions, folks, these are non-negotiable. They don't change with the times. They don't change with the culture. You can't cancel convictions. We need to understand that convictions, especially godly convictions, are set in time and eternity, and that God's the one that sets them. We allow our convictions then to define our character. They define our character, they define our strength. When we are, and if you know somebody who has strong convictions, you know them by their convictions. That becomes a mark of their character, becomes a mark of their strength. One of the most important things about convictions that I discovered during the shooting tragedy at Columbine. Many of y'all remember that years ago. Before we started having almost regular reports of school shootings and public shootings, this one just kind of, I think it slapped our nation in the face when we realized what was taking place. But there was a young girl who was caught up in that by the name of Cassie. And some of you know her story. And some of you know that she was one of the first to have been shot by those two that came in to their school with their weapons. And they came up to her, and she was in a small group, and they just asked her, because they had already heard, "Are you a Christian?" And when she responded yes, they shot her. He shot her. And I've had a lot of young people say, you know, they debated about whether or not she should have said yes. Well, you need to understand that convictions are settled before they become an issue. You don't decide on your convictions in the crucible of the testing of the moment. What caused her to have the courage to say, "Yes, I am a Christian," with a gun facing her, was her conviction. She was not going to deny who she belonged to. And probably most of the important thing about a conviction, especially the ones that I'm going to talk about this morning, is that they are initiated by God. Godly convictions are convictions that definitely need to be non-negotiable. Godly convictions are convictions that definitely should define your character and your strength. And godly convictions are to be settled before they become an issue. Because a conviction, folks, is not an opinion. I hear a lot of people, you know, have opinions. Everybody has an opinion. But a conviction is a choice, whereas an opinion is merely an expression of thought. Conviction is based on one's knowledge of God's Word. That's what I've been trying to say. It's based on knowledge of God's Word and truth. Opinions based on one's feelings at a particular time. How do you feel right now about this particular subject? Convictions are seen in our daily living. Opinion is seldom ever acted upon unless by chance it's challenged or maybe threatened. Somebody may act on their opinion as a matter of principle. But convictions are seen daily. Convictions are held consistently in the face of adversity. Opinion oftentimes is affected by varying circumstances. If somebody thinks they're going to start getting persecuted or punished for their opinion, why, they will change their mind. That's why Christianity is not a result of me convincing you of the claims of Christ or convincing you of anything about the tenets of Christianity. Christianity is not about me convincing you of anything, because that becomes an opinion. And anything that I can convince you of, somebody else can convince you not. And so we need to realize that these convictions never change. Whatever the cost, opinions, they will change to accommodate your feelings or people's persuasion. Everybody's entitled to their own opinion. It's been said that everybody's got one, just like everybody's got a nose. I want to share with you three families this morning. The first one comes from the book of Jeremiah, 35th chapter, if you want to be turning there. We're going to be looking at people who had convictions. Let me just share this one last verse with you before I do. I forgot this one. Romans 14:22 says, "The faith which you have, have as your own conviction before God. Now, the New American Standard uses the word conviction there, and that's why I put that one up there. But if you'll turn in your Bibles to Jeremiah chapter 35, I want to share with you about a family called the Rechabites. I mentioned this Wednesday night. Some of you have already looked into this chapter. You know this story probably now already. But it's an interesting story. You'll notice at the beginning when I said a tale of three families, I had three pictures. And this was one of the pictures. It looks like just a set of goblets and a pitcher. But actually, it's goblets of wine and a pitcher of wine. And if you open your Bibles to Jeremiah chapter 35, you will discover this story, that in Jeremiah chapter 35, Jeremiah was told to by God to take a family, bring them from their home and into the temple of God, and to set before them wine. Beginning at verse 1, the word which came to Jeremiah from the Lord in the days of Jehoiakim, the son of Josiah, king of Judah, saying, go to the house of the Rechabites, speak to them, and bring them into the house of the Lord, into one of the chambers, and give them wine to drink. He then sets the instructions for them, and we see this in the rest of this part. I brought them into the chamber, I set it before them. Verse 5, I set before the sons of the house of the Rechabites bowls of wine, and I said to them, drink wine. When he did, a very interesting thing took place. They disobeyed him. They refused. They said, we will not. In fact, beginning at verse 36, they said to him, we will drink no wine because Jonadab, the son of Rechab, our father commanded us, saying, you shall drink no wine, you nor your sons, forever. Not only did they have that restriction, look at these other two that they had. Looking at verse 7, he says, you shall not build a house, or sow seed, or plant a vineyard. You say, well, what's wrong with those things? Well, absolutely nothing's wrong with them. But they were convictions that were passed down by their father, Jonadab, who got it from his father, Rechab, and they were the Rechabites. All your days you shall dwell in tents, that you may live many days in the land where you are sojourners. And so then they go on to say, thus we have obeyed the voice of Jonadab, the son of Rechab, our father, in all that he charged us. To drink no wine all our days, we, our wives, our sons, and our daughters, nor to build ourselves houses to dwell in, nor do we have a vineyard or field or seed. Now, let me just pause here and say, this is not a message about teetotaling. This is a message about convictions. And the reason it is a message about convictions is because this family is acting upon the convictions of their family. Now, granted, there are some things in here you say, well, there's nothing wrong with living in houses. There's nothing wrong with planting farms or sowing your fields. So what's the purpose behind this? Well, it's very simple. Jonadab, well, actually Rechab from the beginning, told them not to drink wine because wine was prominent in Baal worship. They were coming into a land where the land of Canaan was such a place that Baal worship, we've already seen in other stories, was still going on, still rampant. It was a father's way of keeping his children dedicated to God by keeping them from wine, which was part of the pagan worship of that area. So, well, what about dwelling in tents and not in houses? Well, the Rechabites were descendants of the Kenites through Jethro, Moses' father-in-law. He was a herdsman. He wanted his family to continue. He said, don't plant farms, don't build houses, and you are to keep animals instead of tents. And part of that also was going to help them. Remember, this is coming to you from a time in Jeremiah. Do you know what's getting ready to happen? Families are about to be uprooted. They're about to be sent into exile to Babylon. And of all the people who would be ready for a move, it was the Rechabites. Not only were they protected from the Baal worship. Not only did they not partake of the wine, but they also didn't have farms and houses that they would be leaving. They were basically herdsmen, they were nomads, and they were ready for that kind of movement, that transition that was about to take place. You say, well, why did the prophet then bring them into the temple and set wine in front of them? And he says he did that as an object lesson. This is the lesson of the Rechabites. It's found in verses 18 and 19. Look at chapter 35. Surely the sons of Jonadab, the son of Rechab, have performed the commandment of their father, which he commanded them, but this people have not obeyed me. When Jeremiah was to give this message to Israel, he was saying, here is a family who has held their convictions given to them by their father, their grandfather. They have listened to his voice, and they serve as an illustration to a nation. Not my morning. Let me get some of that. The bottom line is this. Jeremiah was trying to get an illustration, well, not God, God was giving an illustration through Jeremiah through a family that was holding fast to their convictions. And when he did, he was giving an instruction to Israel. Here's a family that's listened to their earthly father all of this time. They have listened to everything he said, and they've done exactly according to his word. But you haven't been listening to your heavenly father. You haven't been listening to the things I've been trying to tell you. And because of that, the judgment of what's about to take place is about to take place. You're going into Babylon because you haven't listened to me. When God's people fail to be the light and the salt that he has called them to be, we will find ourselves in places like pandemics. We will find ourselves in places of judgment. We will find ourselves in situations where God's displeasure with his people will be evident by the things that he does. He says, the Rechabites listened to me, you haven't. Now let me go ahead and move on to the blessing that he gives them. That's right, verse 18, now we're there. The Rechabites said to the house of the Jeremiah said to the house of the Rechabites, thus says the Lord of hosts, the God of Israel, because you have obeyed the commandment of Jonadab your father and kept all his precepts according to all that he commanded you. Therefore, thus says the Lord, the God of Israel. And by the way, you notice I've bolded the phrase, the Lord of hosts. This is the name of God we looked at last Wednesday night. We looked at the Lord of hosts, Jehovah Sabaoth. And here he's referring to himself. Thus says the Lord of hosts, the God of Israel, Jonadab, the son of Rechab, shall not lack for a man to stand before me forever. God-given family convictions are those that are stand even when it appears like everybody else is telling you to do something otherwise. Let me go ahead and save myself and move to the next family. The next family is Lot. Lot and his family. It's found in Genesis chapter 19. And Lot of Genesis 19 illustrates what happens when a family doesn't hold convictions that are godly. And in fact, even though Lot was trying to have a ministry there in Sodom, he fell terribly short, especially with his family. And here's what I want you to see. This is an interesting story. These angels have already been to Abram, and they've already talked, and they've already had their time with Abraham. And Abraham has made an offer to them. He says, what if you get to Sodom and you find 10 righteous people? You're going to destroy the city for 10 righteous people. He starts at 50, finds his way all the way down to 10. And they agreed they wouldn't destroy the city for 10 righteous people. In chapter 19, verse 1, the two angels come to Sodom in the evening, and Lot was sitting in the gate of Sodom. You say, well, what was the purpose of the picture? Well, it's a picture of the gate. And the reason that there was a picture of the gate, because that's where they found Lot sitting. And the gate is significant. He was sitting at the gate, and when Lot saw them, he rose to meet them, and he bowed himself to his face toward the ground, because he knew who they were. But sitting at the gate was a place of not only honor, it was a place of exercising authority and judgment. If you go back and look at some of the stories of the Old Testament, you'll see that the gate is where Boaz presented his appeal in order to take Ruth as his wife, and the matter had to be discussed and the matter had to be settled. The gate is where in Proverbs 31 that says the virtuous woman, her husband is known in the gates. The gate was where Eli sat when he judged Israel. The gate is where the King of Glory enters. When we looked at Psalm 24 last Wednesday night, we talked about who is this King of Glory. He's the Lord of hosts. The King of Glory is coming through the gates. For Lot to be at the city gate was a position of honor. It was a place of authority. It was where they judged matters of the city. And it was his influence, he thought, for that wicked city of Sodom. It was, if you could use the term, his ministry to try to bring light to Sodom. I won't go through all of these verses with you, but verses 2 through 8 is where he tries to persuade them to get off the streets, the two angels before nightfall, and he invites them to come under the protection of his home. In verses 9 through 11, we find the depravity of Sodom literally coming out at night. And by the way, there's no ambiguity about their intentions. There's no ambiguity about the meaning of their desire to know these men. Some would like for you to think that the sin of Sodom was a lack of hospitality. I've heard that before. But God doesn't destroy whole cities for inhospitality. He does so for abomination, for idolatry, and for perversion, as he did with the land of Canaan. But what I want you to see in this story is what takes place when they come to that point of realization of what they must do. A swift reading of the chapter may lead you to think that there's only four members in Lot's family. Lot, his wife, and his two daughters at home. But let's look at verse 12 for just a moment. Then the men, the angels, said to Lot, "Have you anyone else here?" And then they begin to list son-in-law, sons, daughters, whomever you have in the city. And I can't help but understand and realize that as angels of God, as emissaries of God, they probably have been briefed on this mission. And they know that Lot has more than just two daughters at home. And so they ask the question, "Have you anyone else here?" And they begin to list off sons-in-law, daughters, sons. We know he had at least two son-in-laws because he goes out and talks to them and they think he's crazy. So if he has two son-in-laws, he has at least two married daughters besides his two virgin daughters that are at home. But they also mentioned his sons. Well, let's just keep it a minimal. Let's just say that he did have sons, but he only had two. Keep it as low as possible. Two sons, two married daughters, two sons-in-laws, two virgin daughters. Lot, his wife. What did Abraham know before those angels went to that city? That there was at least 10 people in the family of Lot. If Lot had been faithful in godly convictions and passed them on to his family, if his family had been faithful in godly convictions, there would have been at least 10 righteous people in the city of Sodom. But there wasn't, because he hadn't passed his convictions on. He had tried to be a judge for the city, but he had let his family go. And in the process, he not only lost his family, he lost the city. The significance of that number is obvious. I've already mentioned it to you, but back in chapter 18, Abraham said, "Let not the Lord be angry. I will speak but once more. Suppose 10 should be found there." He said, "I will not destroy it for the sake of the 10. But they couldn't find 10 righteous people. Although in 2 Peter chapter 2, verse 7, Lot himself is referred to as righteous. He tried to be a judge in Sodom. And we see that in verse 1. We see it in verse 9 when the men come and they say, you set yourself up to be a judge here. Now we're going to do worse with you than we would have done with them. He lost his influence over his own family. He lost his family. When he lost his family, he lost his ministry. When he lost his ministry, he lost the city. That's the tragedy of Lot. You see, he couldn't maintain the balance between family and his work. And however many convictions he may have had, he didn't pass them on to his family. Let's get on to the last family. This one's a little bit more obvious. Noah, Genesis chapter 7. And Noah in Genesis 7 illustrates what happens when a man does maintain a healthy relationship, a healthy balance between both his calling, his service to God, and his family. In Genesis chapter 7, verse 1, the Lord said to Noah, come into the ark. By the way, let me interrupt myself here and say, did you notice it says come into the ark, not go into the ark? Have you ever noticed that before? God's call was to Noah was to come into the ark. What does that tell you? Where's God? He's in the ark. He says, come join me. Come into the ark, you and all your household, because I have seen that you are righteous before me in this generation. Of the three sons and their wives, all entered into the safety of the ark and literally changed the world. You talk about a godly family. Noah is the epitome of a godly family. All of his children and all of their wives were that which were brought into the ark. We have this Peter commenting on this in his second epistle. If God did not spare the angels who sinned, but cast them down to hell and delivered them into the chains of darkness to be reserved for judgment, and did not spare the ancient world, but saved Noah, one of eight people, a preacher of righteousness, bringing in the flood on the world of the ungodly. And he also got, by the way, brings up the subject of Sodom and Gomorrah in the same passage. He says in the very next verse, turning the cities of Sodom and Gomorrah into ashes, condemned them to destruction, making them an example to those who afterward would live ungodly. And although he delivered righteous Lot, he couldn't save the city because his family hadn't followed in his steps. Because Lot himself had been oppressed by the filthy conduct of the wicked. God has given us gifts and callings and ministry. Here in this church, we have families. Those families need to rise up to be godly examples to this community. And those convictions by which we need to receive and exercise and not just talk about. You only really practice what you believe. Everything else is a bunch of religious talk. We should never sacrifice our families for our callings or our work, and we should never sacrifice our work for our families. We all must develop strong godly convictions and then pass them on to our families. Thank you, Elwood, for your song this morning. Thank you for reminding us of that passage in Joshua that simply says, for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. I want that to be our call to response this morning. I would like that to be what God is calling the families of Medina First Baptist to this morning. I would like for us to realize that this opportunity in the darkness of these days and these times is that for our families to be light, to be salt. And we can't do that, and we can't be that without godly convictions. So this morning I would like to invite you to join me and my family from Joshua 24:15, as for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. Have you made that commitment and that conviction? part of your family? Let's pray.